Ladies and gentlemen, good evening in our new episode of our program Windows. Today we are going to tackle one of the important topics that deal with the AI and administrative apparatus of the state, referring to a very important note by President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi. President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi extended on Sunday, 23rd of June, his greetings and expressed appreciation for public servants of state's administrative apparatus on the occasion of the World Public Service Day, which is celebrated on June 23rd of each year. Actually, the President emphasized on a very important topic or point. He emphasized his support for efforts toward a comprehensive development of the state administrative apparatus at the level of the human resources, efficiency, digital transformation, and information technology, at the fundamental ways for the Egyptian state to build its renaissance and achieve comprehensive development. This will lead us to very important points concerning, we're talking about AI technology. How could we have an impact of AI on the economy, the impact of AI on the level of affecting the service or the public service, the public organizations in Egypt? How far could we get usage of the AI in a good way, in a positive way? Different questions will be raised to our guests today, Engineer Mohammed Azam, board member of the International Association of Management of Technology. Dr. Mohammed, nice to meet you.
Always a pleasure and honor being with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. So, first of all, we'd like to begin with the impact of AI and technology on the civil work, on the civil apparatus of the country, and how far the government play a role, a very important role in such way.
Thank you for this question. Actually, you cannot advance any economy without utilization of technology at large. And of course, utilization of technology is becoming on the top priority of the Egyptian state for many years. We are witnessing a lot of development in this regards when it comes to the provision of public services, for actually automating the workflow within the governmental sectors, all governmental sectors, and also employing technology in advancing the way we are providing services, either to citizens or businesses, as well as technology is becoming, because technology is very simple, becoming the backbone for any development.
Exactly.
You cannot progress any economic or social sector without heavy utilization of technology. And the more you consume technology, the more you will be more competitive, the more you would be more resilient as well. Of course, we've seen a lot of applications when it comes to the public services. We've seen, of course, the Digital Egypt platform that provides like 168 public services to citizens and businesses. And this platform is hosting more than, I would say, 8.5 million users, are almost having something like 45 million transactions using the Digital Egypt platform, and this is only the start. And there are a lot of wide spectrum
projects,
of applications that are taking place nowadays, and this including or under the scope or under the slogan AI for development and technology for development.
And I think this is a very important point. AI for development, I think it's a backbone for sustainable development in Egypt, especially that we have lots of projects that deal with sustainable development. So how far could the Egyptian government succeed in a way that promote the AI and technology to enhance the role of the government service in different ways?
Actually, it's a journey. It has no end, actually. And because the technology is always progressing, and according to the new technologies, according to the new use models of the technology, I need to update myself all the time. That includes updating our infrastructure, and we've seen the irrigation of the huge data center that President Sisi actually witnessed the ceremony of launching this huge data center that hosting all the data related to the government, to the citizens, and they are window also for having a sort of hosting the application of private sector, especially small and medium enterprises who cannot afford paying such a lot of money for such service, because this service is very sophisticated service. So by availing such service to the business community at large through the data center owned by the government of Egypt, this would add a sort of competitiveness to the way we conduct business, and will increase the competitiveness edge of our small and medium enterprises working in different domains. So ICT infrastructure is part of it. We've seen a lot of application with respect to agricultural extension, for example, for as well as for early detection of diseases. And of course, now we are having a complete what's called G2G network, or government to government network. We've seen this with the governmental entities that are in the new administrative capital. Fully automated workflow, fully automated way
but
of transferring documents.
But it's focused only on government bodies, yani, I think governmental bodies, not dealing with non-governmental organizations or the private sector at all. It's not networking between both of them.
Actually, there are two types of networks. Yeah. One of them is G2G, or government to government. This is totally protected, isolated network that connecting all governmental entities all together to exchange documents, to share data, to work on common project together. And there is another network for government to business, or G2B, or government to citizen, G2C. And of course, this totally different network. And through this network, actually, you are providing so many services to the private sector and to the citizens. And as I told you, through Digital Egypt, you have like 168 public services offered, that including so many services related to the your personal IDs for issuing your birth certificate, a lot of things related to the
Badgers
commercial,
the
commercial registration, to having legislation, having a sort of related to the legal framework, the legal system.
It's long process, I think.
Actually, this is actually what's the beauty here. You are re-engineering every service to cope, or to be able to work in the digital medium. Because
and the people themselves, in the training of the people themselves, I think it's very important here.
This very actually important aspect, because the more, the easier you provide the service, you would be able to gain the confidence of, in the service. And we call it what's called the digital trust. Between the government as a provider of the service and citizen and businesses as consumer of the business. That's why you are witnessing a growth on a number related to the number of users on the Digital Egypt platform, as well as we've seen an increase in the number of transactions that are taking place on the Digital Egypt platform. A few months ago, there were like 6 million subscribers. Now we are talking more than 8.5 million subscribers.
Yeah, the number increased a lot.
And a few years, a month ago, actually, we were talking about 30 or 25 million transactions. Now we are witnessing more than 40 or 45 million transactions, and the number is increasing every day. So you are changing the mindset, actually. You are showing that it's an easy way to conduct the service. It's an easy way to consume the service. And of course, this promotes another thing that related to the financial inclusion and electronic payment, because as long as I'm able to get the service online, I don't have to go and pay things in a physical way, or by hard currency, or by cash. So you are changing the mindset, and this is very important in all business aspects.
It's complete cycle. Yani, I think many organizations should be integrated to succeed, to be, yani, to promote or to present provide a successful system for this cycle, يعني not only the government.
Actually, it's all holistic approach. You are integrating so many things together. You are integrating governmental actors with non-governmental actors within the service. And you are now including so many other services coming from the non-governmental actors to be included in the service. That's why it's a journey. Today you have like 168 public services. Tomorrow you'll have more than 220 and so on and so forth, and and the more the easiest way to provide such services is to provide it online, and we have now a different culture, and it's actually is proved by the number of subscribers, the number of transactions, because I don't have to go physically to have the service. On the other way, I have very easy, very convenient way to get my documents or consume my service online. And even if I don't know how to deal with the platform or dealing with the mobile application, there is a call center for providing the same kind of services. And also there is a kiosk in so many post offices, as well as you can find so many mobile vehicles that are providing the same services with the same quality according to very high standard and according to a governed model, because the beauty here is you have a better governance on the way.
This
you
is a very
are
important point, Yani. Definitely. Yes, Yani, we're talking about promoting or the state's administrative apparatus and how we can use AI to promote the performance even of the governmental services. Here is the question, Yani. How can we make an equation, a good equation between governance on one side and promoting good quality of services from the by the government in, on the other side?
By providing services online, actually, or in a digital format, I would say. Because by nature, digital, the digital format of the service provision is governed. If you need to have such service, it should be concluded and provided to the citizen or the business within 3 days, for example. And if you don't able to provide such service within this time framework, the system automatically will escalate things. So you have a sort of governance automatically, and the best way to govern the way you conduct the service is to have it automated.
Yes, and can be easily monitored.
It's fully monitored,
exactly.
It's fully governed. It's you have a sort of standard of service. There is so many standards that you can apply, and of course you don't have human interference. So everything is through the system, and if I'm able to do so, so of course I would be able to have a better way of providing the service. And this also reflects on you as a country on so many international indices, and of course this will increase your competitiveness edge, and because competitive edge is totally now dependent on how to how you are consuming the technology, how you are providing your services in a very transparent, governed way, easy you are providing your service, how the ease of doing business. If I'm planning to have a new venture here in Egypt, and now it's totally different aspect and a totally different approach. You can apply online, you can get your license online, you can have your commercial registration online, you have your tax card online. So you are changing actually the whole mindset, and of course you are sending a different message to the investment community, either the domestic investment community and the international investment community as well.
Yes, an important point also is the relation between AI and the labor market or the task force. I think it's very important, because talking about the labor market in Egypt, how far could we really make usage of the AI and pave the way for a positive environment for the labor market?
This is actually a concern for the whole world.
Yeah,
because
exactly.
AI changes.
This country has its own challenges, of course.
Actually, if you go back to March, I would say 2020, there was an initiative by the World Economic Forum that for reskilling 1 billion actually individuals all over the world, because the technology is always enforcing a different business model. and technology is always altering the job market.
Yes.
This started actually since the first industrial revolution back in the 18th century, when the whole community transformed from agriculture-based community to industrial-based community. So technology is always altering the jobs, not actually eradicating the jobs. Is not eliminating people from doing a specific task. Actually, it needs, that's why it's very important to have a way to reskill yourself, to upskill yourself. And the only way is not only education, by the way, is the ability to learn how to learn, is your ability for having long life learning way of absorbing such new knowledge, absorbing such new skills. And of course, maybe a few decades ago, I need to reskill myself or upgrade my skills once every 5 years or 10 years. Now I need to get new skills, upgrade my skills in less than 2 weeks or 3 weeks. The pace is beyond imagination, and the pace, we cannot do anything about it. And the only way is to learn how to learn. And because all the knowledge materials, all the knowledge channels are now available, and most of the time are free. And the only way to do so is to go and consume such knowledge and to upgrade your skills all the time. Because actually, any routine job can be automated.
Exactly. Dr. Mohammed, research shows that AI can help less experienced workers enhance their productivity. How far could this equation or this information used by different countries like China, for example, Yani, which is a model for productivity in a good way? So what are the countries which really make a very important and successful models for such an idea?
We need to consider AI as our personal assistant. This is very important and becoming very basic, especially in the era of generative AI. I can ask anything, get answers for anything on the planet, because the AI is capable to go deeply and analyze 120 zettabyte of information. The 1 zettabyte is 1 trillion billion gigabytes. It's beyond imagination. I need to use such tool as a personal assistant. I need to use it for getting a better knowledge, for getting more accurate information, to increase my productivity, to have a better way of planning my tasks. And the only way is to deal with such new tools. Otherwise, I'll be outdated, and this would be my own problem, not anyone else's problem. It's becoming a mandate to learn these new tools. There's a new definition of digital skills. Maybe a few years ago, the digital skills is able to deal with the internet, how I conduct search on the internet using the search engines, how I'm using productivity tools for making spreadsheets or writing a document or making a presentation. Now it's totally different thing. Now I need to be able to do a task based on very sophisticated set of knowledge in a very dynamic environment, using totally new tools, and it's easy and it's free.
Like IoT, for example, Internet of Things. I think it's one of the most important points that we have, should be integrated in such system.
Of course, and this is actually the essences of the fourth industrial revolution. Because if you need to be productive, you need to be competitive and to have a footprint in the international marketplace, or even on the regional level, you need to modernize your trade system, you need to modernize your production systems, and of course you need to employ technology again to the maximum. I need to employ AI for productivity. I need to have sensors all the time. I need to have a way of very sophisticated production lines that leading to what's called zero defect production. And actually the world is heading towards having a zero defect production, and you need to have a very way or a sophisticated way or a very advanced way to deal with your supply chain. Actually, we are heading to self-thinking supply chain as well. This is one of the lessons learned from the crisis of COVID, because due to the disruption happened to the global supply chain. That's why we need
the economic crisis all over the world. You know,
it's established a new era that that showed that we need to be more resilient on the national level. We need to be more resilient on the regional level, rather than having such resilience and integration on the international level. So if you need to do so, you need to be capable to integrate all your system together. You need to use such very advanced technology to be productive according to international quality. You need to have a trade system or a supply chain system that is very dynamic, very agile, capable of forecasting the future, capable of dealing with so many unforeseen circumstances that happening. And again, thanks to COVID-19, that showed that we need such systems all over the world, not only in the advanced economies, but also in developing economies at the same level.
So what's also important is people, as we said, that people should be considered the cornerstone of such a system or such way to use or make a relation between AI and the state's administrative apparatus, or providing services, government services, in a good way. So the role of training and the role of empowerment people to be able to use such system, how could we, could you see that there are efforts done by the governments in such way?
There are so many initiatives, actually. There are so many training programs that are taking place, either for youth, for even starting from fourth grade.
The kids also.
The kids, yes, of course, starting from fourth grade up to students in higher school, up to students in universities, and even post-grad, and even for people who want to change their career.
Like Marvels, one of the
A lot of initiatives are taking place, and the training is available and is free of charge. If you need to, even if you graduated from a certain college or university or whatever career, you need to change, you need to have a sort of career shift, and you need to enter this digital era. There are so many courses in so many advanced areas, that including artificial intelligence, cybersecurity, digital arts, digital marketing. The list is unlimited, actually. And also there is training for the public servants to deal with new systems, especially after transforming the government, transferring the government from old Cairo to the new administrative Cairo, to deal with the new systems and to be able to conduct the business in an easy way, in a convenient way, and in an efficient way. And the only way is training, because actually the pace of technological development is reshaping the education system all over the world.
Exactly.
The notion of having standard education for 12 years in school and 4 years in college is becoming obsolete. Actually, it's that's why we see now technological colleges that you can join and go to the job market and rejoin and go to the job market and so on. So
reshaping the education process itself, I think it's
actually otherwise the education process wouldn't be able to cope with such development on the technological side. And of course the job market is always very dynamic and always seeking new skills. The only way is to have agile education system and have up-to-date training system or training mechanism for upgrading and upskilling my skills all the time. Otherwise, I would have obsolete skills that nobody will need.
So I was thinking about the countries, the developing countries, especially developing countries. What are the good examples of the developing countries that succeeded to use relation or a healthy relation between the AI and providing the government services in a good way?
I would say other India, India, China, Brazil, some African countries, including South Africa, Kenya, mm-hmm. Because this is the only way, actually. This is the only way, otherwise, you will be actually obsolete. And if you wouldn't be able to join this space, actually, this would be a high risk on the competitiveness level as an individual or as an enterprise or as a government even or as a nation. Mm-hmm. So there's no choice actually rather than coping with such development and upgrading the whole system to match the dynamics of the new system and mm. to deal with the new business model, because technology is always enforcing a new business model all the time. And this is actually the reality that we need to face in the 21st century. And of course, we're going to witness more development. We're going to witness more business, advanced business model, disruptive business model. So that's why it's journey. You
exactly.
cannot stop it.
You Do we have cooperation or collaboration initiatives with other countries, like in different way, South-South collaboration, talking about development? So do we have certain projects that deal with cooperation with different countries in Africa and Asia that maybe have the same ground on talking about AI and providing the government service?
Definitely, we've seen a lot of efforts that are taking place in this direction across the African continent and across the Arab region. Mm-hmm. Because international cooperation in the domain of AI is one of the Egyptian AI strategy, because nobody can do it alone. The size of investment.
The world should be connected.
Otherwise, you cannot do it alone.
Of course.
Unless you are one of the superpowers, like the United States or China. Actually, China invested $2 trillion in AI over the last decade. This is the size of investment that took place. Mm. That's why for South-to-South cooperation is becoming fundamental in advancing the developing nations.
Yes.
And that's why we've seen a lot of cooperation between Egypt.
Which got China to one of the most important economies all over the world. I think it's one of the greatest countries.
This is the second largest economy.
Or the second, and it would be, I think, the first.
Very soon, if they keep the space, actually, they're going to, maybe they're going to exceed the U.S. economy within a decade or something.
So the relation between the AI and the economy, it's very clear, quite clear. In Egypt here, how could we make usage from such an equation to have maximize the benefit of AI to promote the Egyptian economy?
Actually, you need to develop more applications, and mm. this will lead us to the concept of entrepreneurship, because this is a totally green field. And of course,
it can be major in some universities.
And actually is very attractive to investment community. Mm. Startups, high quality startups, are quite actually an attraction point for attracting more investment. And we are witnessing development in this regard here in Egypt as well. Mm-hmm. Last year, we were like 80 companies, startups were able to attract like $500 million. This year, we're talking about 180 startups were able to attract something like $800 million. So this is very important to build such technology within the country. Mm-hmm. Because only the technology is what makes the difference. Mm-hmm. And of course, there are a lot of programs, a lot of accelerators, incubators for actually helping such great minds here in Egypt. And there are a lot of programs that are mainly focusing on helping either technically or non-technically such great startups, because this could actually change the landscape of investment in Egypt, because in the technological domain, in the high-tech domain, the most important aspect is the brains and the minds of our youth. And we have definitely great minds, and we've seen a lot of great examples. We have a startup, Egyptian startup is considered one of the best 20 startups in the domain of AI worldwide. We've seen a lot of very successful startups in working in financial technology or the fintech. One of them is now listed in London stock market, and other company were able last year to attract like $370 million as round of investment in very small company, a startup that is actually has a few great minds. So the dynamics here is very important, and of course this is very important aspect that we need to work on it, and we need to focus on it, and to have more great minds capable of delivering very high value.
Yes, human beings, again.
Definitely, 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 because startups are based on great minds. A great idea that could be implemented with a great team, and of course this would be make you able to have more investment, and this is the way we could change the landscape of investment climate here in Egypt, and we are progressing a lot in this direction.
Also a very important point, the ethical usage of AI, and I think it's very important talking about legislations and the culture of people that deal with AI in different agencies.
This is another concern, actually.
It's very important because
actually most of the countries all over the world are talking about how we can could control or regulate.
Ignoring this aspect could bring us to the negative side of AI.
It could be leading to a disaster.
Yeah, exactly.
That's why we need, actually Egypt launched or introduced an ethical framework for using AI. And this ethical framework is the first one in across the Middle East and Africa. We are talking here about AI should be developed for the benefit of human beings. Should be developed not as a replacement of humans, unless for high risk, high hazard jobs. AI is not developed to take decisions on the behalf of humans. I need to, as a user, to know that I'm dealing with AI. It's very important, and the final decision should be for humans. Also, I need to develop an AI to avoid discrimination, not increasing discrimination and bias.
Very important.
Because I can use algorithm for in a financial service, for example, and saying don't give loans or credit for women or people with disabilities. So that's why it's very important to use AI to eliminate discrimination, not increasing discrimination and bias. And of course, we should open also a lot of international cooperation venues between nations, because this is something new to the whole world. And the developing and developed nations should work together for having a safer AI, for having AI for the benefit of human beings, not the opposite. Because if I'm going to not regulate such, I would say, monster, this could lead to a lot of ethical issues, and could lead to a lot of, I would say, disasters, or even very serious areas that concerned about the ethical use of AI, especially in conflicts, and especially in cyber crimes, especially in
even culture. The movies, Hollywood has a different crisis concerning using the AI, or the usage of AI in making movies, script writing, and I think it was one of the topics that were raised in USA, for example.
This is actually made a lot of problems in large industry, like or huge industry in Hollywood, because of course I can use AI to do a lot of things. But however, creativity is only by humans. AI is not creative till now, to be honest, because we are going to witness or are witnessing a huge development based on the machine learning or the deep learning. The machine is teaching itself. And it could lead us to one day to have what's called the super intelligent phenomenon. Which is actually Hollywood introduced a lot of such things in so many movies and science fiction movies. However, we might reach it, we might not reach such stage. That's why we need to govern
the usage of the,
course. And
of
this is
AI.
One of the concern of so many countries all over the world, and so many governments are working on regulating if AI not killing the innovation, but or actually lessen the speed of the innovation, but for having a responsible use of AI to have the advancement of this technology for the benefit of humans, not and the human race, not the opposite.
Dr. Mohammed, يعني Engineer Mohammed, I really enjoyed يعني this conversation because it opened lots of discussion concerning AI and how the state's administrative apparatus in Egypt could make use of the AI technology in promoting different government services in such a good way. Thank you for being with us, Engineer Mohammed Azem, board member of the International Association of Management of Technology. Glad to have you.
Thank you so much. Always a pleasure and honor in being with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So
we came to the end of our episode. Thank you for following us. Next week, have a different topic. So goodbye.